Jesus is coming soon. And before he does, there'll be a tremendous deception in the Christian world. Paul describes a deception taking place in his time in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 through 15. We read that there were false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light or truth. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. It's hard for us to imagine that religious leaders throughout the years may have brought into the church false doctrines. But the fact is that just before Jesus comes, two groups of Christians will be formed. There'll be one group that is waiting for Jesus and ready for him when they see him in the clouds of glory. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 12, we read a description of them. Here is the patience or endurance of the saints. Here are they that keep or obey the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus, the experience of Jesus. Another group is brought to view that are lost when God comes to this earth. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 9, we read, "And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worship the beast in his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, verse 10, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb." It seems extremely important that you and I understand what the beast is and what his mark is. But how do we identify the beast and his mark? This world is being held captive by an evil power. That power has been here since the dawning of mankind. This power is trying to destroy every man, woman, and child in this world. And God brings it to view in Revelation chapter 13, verse 18. "Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. The number 666 is the number of a beast and the number of a man. It is the identifying mark of this power. We have to go back in time to the first civilization on the plains of Shinar in Mesopotamia. Here, as these nomads found a home in that fertile land, they had to confront dangerous creatures. This required an extermination process to make the land safe for them. The man that led out in that work was a man by the name of Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. This statue in the Pergamon Museum describes this early hero under the name of Gilgamesh. Nimrod killed a bull with his bare hands, a tremendous feat, even in an age of giants. He also killed a lion with his bare hands, and these feats became symbols of his authority and his right to rule. Cylinder seals dating 3,000 years before the time of Christ show this great hero and his work of hunting. He also became a god to those people and forced them to worship himself. He wore the cloak of a lion as a symbol of his right to rule, and he wore the horns of the bull as his first crown. In time, the area of Shinar and Babylon broke up into various small countries, each with its own king. Each of these kings continued the tradition of having to kill a lion. Nimrod became the builder of the first great city. He's known as the great builder, the tower builder or bridge builder, the term Pontifex Maximus. He directed the people to build walls, but he's most noted for the building of a great tower. This tower was built in dedication to the astrological gods and especially the sun. It was in rebellion against God, the creator of the universe. Nimrod had a beautiful wife, a blonde and blue-eyed woman who captivated the senses of his kingdom. She led out in the first blood sacrifices and witchcraft rites. When Nimrod died, this goddess, Semiramis, directed the people to worship her as they had her husband. She took the religion into the mysteries in order to protect herself from those who would want to destroy it. She was the mother of all female or mother worship. Throughout the world, various myths and legends have continued from her time, giving her various names. Semiramis had a beautiful child. He was the son of an illegitimate relationship, and she taught the people that the power of Nimrod, who had ascended into the sun, came over her, and she had a virgin birth. They believed that this was the reincarnation of their god Nimrod, and so the people worshipped him. When he became a young man, he was killed by a wild boar. The boar became a symbol of the destroyer of the gods, and the people wept for their lost life giver, their lost savior. Semiramis directed the people to worship the life giver in the sun, claiming that he had ascended to the heavens in 3 days. Indeed, all of the early astrological gods of Babylon were previously believed to be the departed spirits of their kings and their heroes. Thus was born in that land the worship of astrology. The stars became the chief focus of the priest. They watched their movements through the heavens. They plotted their movements according to the events that took place on this earth. And thus the priests believed that they were able to foretell the influences that these rulers of the heavens would have on life on this earth. They alone, the initiated priests, were allowed to know this secret knowledge. But in all their worship of the stars and the sun and the moon, they were in fact worshiping the departed spirits of their dead, and the religion of Babylon was the worship of the dead. The sun, of course, was the chief god. Its movements through the skies was carefully marked. They saw that it passed through a consistent path in the heavens. This path they called the zodiac. During the day, they saw the sun as a good god, but at night, a dark and evil god. The union of the god who ruled the sky and the seas gave rise to many myths and many strange creatures. The number six was the day that man was born on, or created on, and believed to be the day the serpent was made on. Thus, it represented man, woman, and the serpent. There were six houses given for the sun to pass through in the zodiac during the day, and six houses in the night. In each one of those houses, the sun passed through three rooms. This formed 36 rooms in the zodiac. 36 manifestations of the sun, the ancients believed. There were 36 gods in the zodiac, one for each one of these rooms. 36 gods in all to rule the 36 constellations of the sky. The number 1 through 36 added up equals the summary number of the mystery god, the hidden one, the 666 god. These superstitious mystics gave the number 666 to the sun. They believed that the serpent power resided in the sun, and they worshiped this force in nature as a great seven-headed dragon. Each one of its heads representing one of the planetary gods, the Sun, Moon, Mars, Mercury, Jupiter, Venus, and Saturn. They believed that this energy flowed from the sun throughout all nature, and that those who were initiated into the secret teachings of magic were capable of manipulating these forces through mental exercises, through magic words and numbers. When God destroyed this system at the confounding of the languages at the Tower of Babel, priests now speaking different languages spread with the people throughout this world. The result of this spread was that the mystical mystery teachings of Babylon continued to be taught by the priests in every part of the globe and in every age. Remnants of that early religion can be seen in the great towers and pyramids that reflect that first tower of Babylon dedicated to the system of astrology and the sun. In the centuries that followed the time of Nimrod, Babylon came under the control of other kings. But 600 years before Christ, the Babylonians rose up and overthrew their Assyrian rulers. Now Babylon was the ruler of the nations again. Nebuchadnezzar and his father conquered the other countries. They took their kings and they made them into eunuchs. Their princes became servants in the house of Nebuchadnezzar. He also finished that tower, the ziggurat of Babylon. This ziggurat on display in San Jose Rosicrucian Museum illustrates that tower as described by Herodotus. The black base of the tower represented Saturn, the mystery or the hidden god that the Babylonians gave the number 666 to. The next level was represented by Jupiter. The next level, Mars. Then the Sun. Then Venus. Then Mercury and the Moon. And so the tower represented the seven astrological gods that moved through the circle of the zodiac. The palaces and the temples of Babylon were largely plated with gold. Babylon was known as the Golden City, and in her streets, the festivals of the sun, the ancient cult from Babylon, were worshipped again. Although now Nimrod and his wife had different names. Semiramis was now called Ishtar, and her son, Tammuz. The main entrance to Babylon was the beautiful Ishtar Gate, dedicated to this moon goddess. It was blue, the color of the female. On the gate is a symbol of gods. Babylon developed 5,000 gods that the priests used to keep the people in superstitious bondage. The courts and the precincts of the temples were guarded by these great cherubim, part bull, part eagle, part man, and part lion creatures. This god in the British Museum is Umdugud, symbolizing the sun. One of the most respected gods of Babylon was the sacred palm tree, a symbol of the rebirth of life. The 666 god of Babylon was symbolized also as a statue named Marduk. These priests you see in the sacred ark bringing Marduk down the river were from the College of Pontiffs that surrounded the high priest, the Babylonian religion. That high priest was the king, the Pontifex Maximus. He ruled the country as God ruled the earth. His words were law, and his number as well was 666. Under his direct authority were the mystical priests and magicians of Babylon. These people controlled all education, all the economy and business. They were the masters of the world that they lived in. The people showed them reverent homage and worshiped them as if they were gods. It was inconceivable to them that they could ever lose their power with such monumental bastions of walls surrounding them, the fact that they had international connections. But in the mountains to the east, the Persian armies were growing and developing. They had their own priesthood and their own gods based on that early religion of the Mesopotamian Valley. When their soldiers moved in to the river underneath the gate of Babylon, it was providential that the leave gates of the city were left open, and they conquered in one night. They brought with them their gods, very similar to the gods of Babylon. About this time, the Hebrew religion had spread throughout the world, and a man named Zoroaster designed a religion that would compete with that of the Hebrew prophets. He created a god that stood between light and darkness, a god that men worshipped on Sunday, a god that men ate. Other gods throughout the world reflected the same form of religion, the god of nature, the god of the grains, the god of the rivers, the god of the generative powers. All these were worshipped, and behind the myths of these gods were secret allegorical meanings that only the initiates could know. These secret teachings in Egypt fell under a number of different cults: the cult of Horus, or the cult of Isis, and the cult of Hermes. Hermes became the most popular of all the cults. Hermes was believed to be at one time a man searching for the knowledge of truth. He received instruction from a great dragon stretched across the sky. 42 mystical books were written by Hermes called the Hermetic Mysteries. These were kept in the great library at Alexandria, Egypt. The ancient philosophers, Plato, Socrates, Pythagoras, those men who became the father of the modern educational system, were initiates into the mysteries of Hermes. The magicians and priests of Babylon, realizing that their control of the world had faltered, determined to set themselves into a movement to regain it again. They fled Babylon and took their sacred statues with them. They went to the new burgeoning empire of Asia Minor. There, in the country of Pergamum, they established a city, a great acropolis called the Acropolis of Pergamum. Here they built temples to all of the great gods. The most important temple of all was the temple dedicated to the god Zeus. The front of this temple has been rebuilt in the Pergamum Museum in East Berlin, and all around the front of it is a great facade that shows the war of the great gods. In the temple itself, these priests kept a giant serpent. That serpent, or Asculapius, was a god of pharmacopoeia, or sorcery, fascination with drugs and hypnotism and the magical arts. In these temples, they taught students how to carry on these rites of magical healing. The Babylonian priests continued to worship their secret gods. And in 168 BC, when Rome conquered the world, it was their plan to enter Rome and take over the world from there. In 133 BC, the last of the priest kings of Pergamum bequeathed the priesthood of Pergamum, the Chaldean priesthood, to Rome. And there they brought their Palladian and their sacred altar stone. Their god Stur, or Saturnus, added up to the number 666 in the Chaldean hieroglyphs. In Rome now, these priests continued to wear that sacred number in these amulets known as the Sigilla Solis. These photographs were taken in Berlin in 1910. On the front of these sacred amulets were the numbers 1 through 36 scrambled up, the 36 gods of the zodiac. As you add up each row, it comes to numbers 111. As you add the summary number of those digits, you come to the number 666, the number of the hidden or mystery god. The penetration of the religion of Babylon became so general and so well known that Rome was called the New Babylon, Faith of Our Fathers by Cardinal Gibbons, page 106. Now, Babylonian priestcraft, the cult of the sun, ruled the world again from Rome. It was at this dark hour in Earth's history that Jesus Christ came into this world, and through him, God flowed into this world, his spirit, into human hearts. The power of Satan was being broken, and we saw him move in some of the most terrible scenes of persecutions against this movement, but it couldn't be stopped. Tertullian, one of the early church fathers, announced that the blood of martyrs is seed. Every one that died resulted in many more converts to the faith. Now, God had warned the Hebrew people that they were not to walk in the manner of the nations which he had cast out before them. They had committed abominations. But we understand from the Apostle Paul that the very apostasy of the occult world would arise in the church. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, Paul gives a prophecy of what would happen to the church before the coming of Christ. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he, as God, sitteth in the temple, the Greek word naos, meaning the dwelling place of God, showing himself that he is God. When Paul uses the word temple in the New Testament, he refers to the Christian church. A power would arise, exalting a man above God in the Christian church. How did this system of apostasy come into the church? At the time of the apostles, a man by the name of Simon Magus was brought to view as they entered into Samaria. There, this man was a great magician, and he had an entire town under his spell. Simon Magus was never converted to Christianity. He was a master of the occult arts, an initiate into the Hermetic mysteries. He made his way to Rome, and there he was believed to be a god. But he taught the people that he was Jesus Christ. A tremendous temple was built for him there. He established his center of worship in a place called the Vatis Khan, the divining serpent. Later, Simon Magus died, and he was buried there in the Vatican Hill in Rome. Others that spun off from this apostate Christian movement established their own cults. This great movement was called the Gnostic Society, and we find that some of the leading families in the occult world called themselves Christians, but had seals that reflected the pagan gods of astrology. In 1945, in Upper Egypt, in a little town called Nag Hammadi, a number of books were discovered in a cave. These books were sacred writings and appeared to have on them the names of many of the apostles. But who really wrote these books? It became evident in studying them that many occult teachings, spiritualistic teachings that the apostles had never taught, had been written into Christian gospels and passed off as if they were really inspired by God. This Gnostic movement, this counterfeit movement of Christianity, resulted in a deterioration and a destruction of many of the fundamental beliefs of apostolic Christianity. One thing that it did is it led men to allegorize and mythologize the scriptures to fit their own intellectual and philosophical views. These men believed that only the pneumatic part of man was redeemable, or that only the spirit of man was redeemable, a purely pagan principle up to that point. They de-emphasized the concepts of eschatology, or the prophecies leading to the coming of Christ, in favor of the existential movement, the experience. It was these men who brought into the church the pagan concepts of oracular voices or ecstatic utterances, tongues. They minimized the concept of disobedient, claiming that men could never obey, and that the law of the Old Testament was an evil law and had to be destroyed. Thus, they introduced antinomianism into the Christian world. They didn't believe that the miracles of God were anything special. They taught that any man could do miracles. They de-emphasized the concepts of evil angels, fallen angels. Theology became a system of philosophy, and important words of the Bible were just spiritualized away. The cardinal doctrine of the movement was the non-flesh of Jesus Christ. These people claimed that Jesus was only pure light because only pure light was God, and anything physical was in itself evil. Therefore, man being evil could never obey the law, and his work was just to come to know the light, and he would be redeemed and saved. The Gnostic error that Jesus had a different kind of body than we are was a doctrine that has changed the face of the entire Christian world. John called it the teaching or the spirit of the Antichrist. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 2 and 3, we read, "Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world." How did this strange teaching come into our Christian church? Well, the answer is simple. Many of the early church fathers felt that the highest form of worship was to unite the tenets of paganism and Christianity together. Such was the work of men like Jerome and Augustine. It was Augustine who had been a Manichaean Gnostic for 10 years of his life, and he believed that human flesh could not obey the law of God. Thus, he merged his Gnostic concepts with the teachings of Christianity by developing the teaching of original sin. In this view, the idea was that Adam passed on the guilt and taint of sin to his offspring, and that because of that, every child born is born a sinner and cannot obey God's law, even with divine help. This resulted in concepts such as the Immaculate Conception of Mary, and in the Protestant religion, the idea that Jesus must have, through a miracle of birth, escaped the original taint of sin so that he could obey. But what flesh did Jesus actually take? We learn that in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. "For as much then as the children are partakers of the flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same." Jesus took the same flesh that you and I have, and through faith in divinity, he was able to perfectly obey the law of God. He was our example, and the character that he formed is a character that he'll impart to you and to me by faith. We have to obey God's law to be ready for his coming. In the book of Revelation, we read that at the end of time, there will be one small group ready for his coming. Revelation chapter 14, verse 12. "Here are the patience of the saints. Here are they that obey the commandments of God and the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ." We cannot expect to meet salvation with erroneous views of the Antichrist. We've got to study the Bible for ourselves. Look to Jesus as the author and the finisher of our faith. Obey his commandments through faith in him and be ready for his coming. In 312, the Roman general Constantine claimed to be converted to this new paganized form of Christianity. He claimed that while en route to battle, he had seen a cross in the heavens. In following this cross, he won the battle and claimed the victory for Jesus Christ. When Constantine came to power, although he was a worshiper of the god Apollo, he claimed that he was a Christian. Coins that were made after that showed sun symbols all around him. In this painting in the Vatican, it shows Constantine giving the statue symbolizing the political power of the kingdom to the Bishop of Rome at that time. Whether or not this really happened is irrelevant, for we know that somehow the Bishop of Rome became the ruler of the entire Christian world. It's assumed that the Roman Catholic Church became the political authority over Rome. In this painting in the Vatican, we see the cross of Calvary taking the place of the statue of the sun god in a pagan temple. What really happened during those years? Well, in order to attach to Christianity great attraction in the eyes of nobility, the priests adopted outer garments and adornments which were used in pagan cults. From the life of Constantine by Eusebius, cited in Altai Nimalaya, page 94. So the Christians adopted, number one, priesthood, which was not a concept in Christianity, but pagan, and adopted the garments of these priests. What we see the priests wearing today in the Christian church are, in fact, pagan outfits. The church did everything it could to stamp out such pagan rites, but had to capitulate and allow the rites to continue with only the name of the local deity changed to some Christian saint's name. Religious Tradition and Myth by Dr. Edwin Gudenor, professor of religion at Harvard University, page 56 and 57. So the church adopted the pagan gods and gave them Christian names. Many of the gods we see, or the statues that we see in the Christian churches of the day, were originally gods that the pagans bowed down and offered sacrifice to. Confiding then in the power of Christianity to resist the infection of evil and to transmute the instrument and appendages of demon worship to an evangelical use, the rulers of the church from early times were prepared, should occasion arise, to adopt or imitate or sanction the existing rites and customs of the populace. Development of Christian Doctrine by Cardinal Newman, page 372. And in the next page, he gives an entire list of paganism that had come into the Christian church. So the rites of Christianity today are pagan in origin by the church's own admission. From the foregoing, which treats merely of the more important solar festivals, it is clear that these products of paganism are as much in force at present as they ever were, and that the Christianity countenances and in many cases has actually adopted and practiced pagan rites whose heathen significance is merely lost sight of because attention is not called to the source whence these rites has sprung. So heavy was this infiltration that Sir Samuel Dill exclaims Christianity is only a sect of Mithraism. Roman Society from Nero to Marcus Aurelius, page 7. We know that Mithraism was the state religion of Rome at the time that the Christian church was established there. Evidently, tenets of Mithraism, such as Sunday worship and eating the wafer in the Mass, were adopted into Christianity at that time. Mithra worship was the worship of astrology and the worship of the mystical sun god and the god of nature. In short, sun worship, symbolically speaking, lies at the very heart of the great festivals which the Christian church celebrates today. And these relics of heathen religion have, through the medium of their sacred rites, curiously enough, blended with practices and beliefs utterly antagonistic to the spirit which prompted them. Sun Lure of All Ages by Alcott, page 248. Scholars of the world, historians, and church leaders themselves admit that Roman Christianity is in fact pagan idolatry in a Christian guise. The symbols of the pagan world have been adopted into the Christian church and claimed sanctified by the union. In the book, The Secret Teachings of All Ages by Manly P. Hall, we read, "Yet the cross itself is the oldest of the phallic emblems, and the lodge-shaped windows of the cathedrals are proof that the Ionic symbols have survived the destruction of the pagan mysteries. The very structure of the church itself is permeated with sexual symbolism or phallicism. Remove from the Christian church all emblems of priapic or sexual origin, and nothing is left. When we look into the Christian churches today and see those windows, the layout of the floors and the arches and the domes, we're looking at symbols of raw pagan sexual worship. The spires of the churches, the courtyards, all reflect the early concepts of sexual worship. When the zealots of the primitive Christian church sought to paganize Christianity, the pagan initiates retorted with a powerful effort to paganize Christianity. The Christians failed, but the pagans succeeded. With the decline of paganism, the initiated pagan hierophants transferred their base of operations to the new vehicle of primitive Christianity, adopting the symbols of the new cult to conceal those eternal verities which are ever the priceless possession of the wise." So, Christianity became the actual home of the pagan leaders in that age. Pagan men, now claiming to be Christian, were leading out. the world cloaked with a form of righteousness walked into the Christian church. Now the work of corruption rapidly progressed. Paganism, while appearing to be vanquished, became the conqueror. Her spirit controlled the church. Her doctrines, ceremonies, superstitions were incorporated into the faith and worship of the professed followers of Christ. From the Christian history book, The Great Controversy, page 50. Paul had warned about the dangers of Gentile worship. In 1 Corinthians 10:20, he told the Christian church, "But I say that the things which a Gentile sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and the table of devils." Christianity had become devil worship from beginning to end. As we look at the sacrifices and worships of the pagan world around them, knowing that this worship was ascending up before Satan and his evil angels, we're realizing that the Christian church, in adopting these same forms, were in fact sending their worship up before the same powers. In a comparison between sun worship and Christianity, we find an exact parallel today. The nativity of the sun, the birth of Tammuz, December 25th, is now called Christmas. The Midsummer Festival, that's held June 24th, is now called the Nativity of St. John. And the Assumption of Semiramis, who became the mother goddess in paganism, is now called the Assumption of Mary, who became the mother of God. The mother goddess was worshipped and titled the Queen of Heaven. And that's the title that the Virgin Mary is given today. Cakes were decorated and dedicated to the goddess with a T crossed on it. Those are called the hot cross buns in the church today. The 40 days of fasting and lamentation for Tammuz are now called Lent in the Christian church. The festivals of Easter are still called Easter, and the resurrection of Tammuz at Easter and the procession of graven images during Holy Week is now the procession of the graven images of Jesus, Mary, and Peter, and of the saints. The veneration of graven images of Ishtar, Tammuz, and lesser gods of the heavens in the temples and in the courtyards is now the veneration of graven images of Jesus, Mary, and the saints. The belief in the immortality of the soul and the burning place of torment went on thousands of years in pagan idolatry. The doctrine of purgatory was borrowed from the concept of purgation of the Greek philosophy. The belief of the dead visiting the living, the feast, this feast held for in November, called All Souls Day, is now the festivals of All Souls Day in Christianity. We know it as Halloween. The concept of burning incense before the altars was pagan. Chants, repetitious prayers, and beads are now called the rosary in the church. The symbol of the cross was a symbol of the sun and a symbol of Satan. And now it's become the object of worship in the Christian church. Amulets, idols were worn to scare away evil spirits in paganism, and now it's the wearing of crucifixes. The round disc wafer with IHS symbolizing Isis, Horus, and Seb that was eaten for the soul in Egypt is now the wafer of the Eucharist in the church. The painting of the child and the mother with the glory of the sun around them is now called the icons in the Eastern Catholic Church. Infant baptism and sprinkling, all of these things were pagan. The concept of necromancy, talking to the dead, takes place in Christian mysticism and miracles in the church today. The first day of the week, or Sunday, was kept in honor of the sun god in every culture. And today, the Christian world is honoring that day. The concept of Pontifex Maximus, the name of the chief pagan deity, is now the Pontifex Maximus of the Christian church. Janus and Sybil were once the holders of the keys in Asia Minor, and now the Pope claims to be the holder of those very same keys. The concept of a high priest king carried on the throne is seen in the Pope being carried in the Sedia Gestoria. The pagan high priest king was believed to be the incarnate sun god, a representation of the God in heaven. The Pope claims to be the vicar of God on earth. Offerings were offered to placate and appease the god. These concepts became penance and indulgences, salvation by works in the church. Anciently, there were houses for prostitutes, priestesses. Today, the church has adopted the concept of nuns. And throughout the years of sun worship, the enemies of the sun were offered as human sacrifices. And in the Christian Inquisition, over 50 million lives were destroyed. Many of them were burned at the stake. A comparison between this cult form of Christianity in Rome and Hinduism, again, gives us a direct parallel. In Romanism, the Bible was kept away from the laity and put in an obscure language, and only the priest was believed to understand it. In Hinduism, it was believed that only the priest could understand the Vedas, and it was kept from the common people. The use of rosary or beads are to be found in Hinduism. The concept of penance is to be found in Hinduism. The prayers that are given for the dead are to be seen in Hinduism as well. The concept of a last rite as a man dies is to be found in Hinduism. The concepts of candles burning on All Saints' Days can be seen in the Diwali festival of Hinduism, and the relics of the saints or of the holy dead that are honored in the Christian church is a worship that has come from 2,000 years before in Hinduism. We know that Romanism sits up and watches the corpse at death, and so does the system of Hinduism. Candles burned around the grave or the dead is to be seen in Hinduism as well. Sanctuary lamps are seen in both the Hindu temple and in the Roman Catholic Church. Candles that are kept burning before images in the church were seen thousands of years burning before the images in Hinduism. Pilgrimages to shrines in Europe and the Catholic world today can be seen in the pilgrimage paths crisscrossing the Hindu world. Holy palm leaves are placed in the caskets in the Christian church, and holy grass was used in Hinduism for the same purpose. In Roman Catholicism, the Madonna and the Child are worshipped, the Queen of Heaven and her divine son. In Hinduism, it was the worship of Lankriya and Deva, goddess and Queen of Heaven, and her chief son Indra, King of Heaven. The comparison between the initiations between the Christian nuns and the Pujnis, or the nuns of Hinduism, are identical in almost every way. Is Christianity Hinduism? Roman Christianity is Hinduism. Roman Christianity is sun worship. And even today, these rites are continued. As we go into the great Christian cathedrals of worship, we find that the rounds of ceremony there, the worship there, is in fact the ancient worship that began on the plains of Shinar in Babylon so many centuries ago. How far did the church go in her compromise with pagan idolatry? I'm afraid that the facts would be shocking to you. We find in the book written by Richard Payne Knight on sexual symbolism that the church in southern Italy as late as the 18th century was still encouraging her people to bring to the church symbols of their sexual organs to be offered to the saint Cosmos, originally called Priapus by the pagans. It was discovered that in southern France, the church had sexual organs carved in the apex of their doorways for the people to look at as they entered the sanctuary. The most surprising and shocking part of this vulgar worship was the worship of Priapus in southern France, where this sexual god was placed as a statue under the name of Saint Photon in the sanctuary, and the young women were encouraged to give their virginity to it. God did not leave us without warning. We find that the Bible gives a clear picture of not only what God requires of man for salvation, but of the great dangers that face us in our war to keep the truth pure. The last of the apostles, John, was exiled to the Isle of Patmos. There it appeared that his work for the Lord was over with, but we find that God gave him a number of visions. Those visions gave a description of the history that God's people would face up until the end of time. John was given a vision of how close Jesus was to the church and how much he loved them and how he was taking care of them. Jesus was a great high priest in heaven, ministering his righteousness, his counsel, his rebuke, and his warnings to his people. John was given a view also of the enemy of the church through its various forms. He saw the Roman pagan system as a great seven-headed dragon, and he also saw rising from that allegorical sea a monstrous beast with seven heads and 10 horns. In fact, this beast was made up of symbols that was a combination of all of the systems of pagan idolatry that had dominion over the earth from the time of Babylon. What power came after the Roman pagan system passed off the scene? It was the Roman Church. And this great beast, which is a compromise of all the paganism of the fact, was in fact the Roman Catholic system. We find also in Revelation chapter 17 a magnificent view of the church as a harlot who has turned away from God and united with the political powers of this world. This woman's name is Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And the Lord has warned us to not be a part of her. There are many ways of proving that the teachings of Babylon and the system of 666 have filled the church. Ancient Babylon is now ruins today. The land of Mesopotamia is just a waste place. But we find the curse that resides over Babylon is also over religious teachings. In the time of John, the ancient cults were almost a thing of the past. They were dying in strength. It was necessary for these mystics to regain their power through taking over the new system of Christianity. But they maintained their pagan idolatry. In the British Museum, this great boundary stone from Mesopotamia gives 5 symbols of the sun. Indeed, all of the boundary stones that are to be found around the Mideast give symbolism of the deities of the sun, the moon, and the stars in nature. Only those conversant with the secret language of antiquity are capable of understanding the divine significance of these emblems from the secret teachings of all ages. Evidently, these symbols ever remained the same in their value, but their public meanings change from age to age. The number 6 can be stated in many different ways through the G, symbol of God, Gnosis, generation, geometry, and goat. The S, O, V, and U were all serpent symbols. 3, 4, 7, 8, and 10 were numbers that were used to represent this cosmic power. The arrow, the cross, the circle and the cross, the stigma, and the 1 all symbolize the generating principle of the sexual god of nature. The next row represented this great seven-headed serpent, this great 666 power, the Trinity of heaven. And the last row, the S, or the shin of the Hebrew alphabet, was a trident symbolizing Trinity. The pentagram represented the forces of nature. Up, when one point pointed up, it represented the upper houses of the zodiac. When it pointed down, it represented the rulership of the lower houses of the zodiac. The equilateral triangle equals 360 degree angles, and when it was placed over itself, like this hexagram, or the six-pointed star, it symbolized the generative powers of nature and became the evil star in witchcraft. All of these symbols represented the same thing. The occult priests believed in one monotheistic force that surrounded them and flowed throughout all nature, but they taught the people a superstitious fear religion of many, many gods. They surrounded these poor people's lives with myths and symbols of gods. The supreme symbol of God was the sun. We find the sun was pointed to as the source of all life and of all health. The reflection of the god of the sun in the underworld was believed to be the gold that was found in the earth, and so it was holy. It was this sacred gold that was kept in the pagan temples, and the gods were plated with it. When the church took over the pagan world, she also adopted gold. And we find that within the cathedrals and the churches of the Christian world today, there is gold, gold, gold everywhere. The treasuries are filled with gold. The statues are gold. And the architecture is gold. In fact, the church itself has the largest percentage of gold of any organization in the world. As the ancients squinted at the sun, it became a cross in their eyelids, and so the cross was the first hieroglyph or symbol of the sun. We see it here on that boundary stone in the British Museum for Mesopotamia on the chest of the god, on these cylinder seals from 3,000 years before Christ, and on coins throughout the pagan world, this cross was universal. On this seal, we find that the circle and the cross is united. This symbol of male and female in union was adopted in Africa as a symbol of fertility among the natives. And in Egypt, it is the Ankh, the symbol of the immortal life. Here, the apostatizing Christians in the Coptic culture adopted the pagan symbol of life as a symbol of their religious teachings. It had no connection with the cross of Calvary when it was first adopted into the church. The cross of the pagan god was taken into the church in every form before her history was over with. And today, we find that these crosses and pagan symbols are to be found on her altars, in her architecture. We find that the cross is the main object of worship in the church today. It's hung around the neck as an amulet. The priests lay in the shape of it in the floor in their initiation. Another form of the cross is this double cross, the ancient Babylonian sun god Shamash. We see it reflected in symbolism all over Mesopotamia. Here it is in this coin from Greece. And here it is in the floor of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, Italy. This double cross can be found everywhere in the church. Another form of the sun god is this symbol of a wheel within a wheel. It's found on Apollo's chariot. And in this Assyrian sun god, this Egyptian god Hathor, the eye of Osiris, is a wheel. Just as in Karnak, India, there are wheels all around the temple complex there. This Buddhist solar wheel is found in Thailand, a Persian solar wheel, Greek solar wheels. And this Roman solar wheel is in a libation bowl of this Roman priest. In 1963 in Tikal, this sacred libation bowl was discovered. It's a wheel within a wheel. And if you'll notice the double cross and then the single cross in the middle, it's a perfect solar wheel, just like the wheel in St. Peter's Square at St. Peter's Basilica, the largest solar wheel in the world. Solar wheels can be found all over the churches today. Wheels in the ceilings and wheels in the floor. Here we see a picture of a bishop holding a wheel and a painting of Mary holding a wheel herself. Another form of the wheel from the Orient is the wheel of life, the Buddhist wheel of life. It represents the three aspects of the cosmic forces and can be seen on their advertisements and in their work. This Shinto shrine in London shows this solar wheel of the sun, three sixes in union. And just down the street and around the corner is Westminster Cathedral. And on the floor in one of her chapels is the same oriental solar wheel, three sixes in union. Sol, or the sun god, was universally worshipped throughout the world. We found not only in Rome, but in Greece. This face in the sun, representing the spirit of the sun, can be seen. Here on a temple in Greece is the god Apollo. Notice the straight and wavy lines. It represents the merge of male and female. The very same symbolism is to be found on this Catholic altar or in this Catholic pulpit in Scandinavia and on this Jesuit chapel. In Burgos Cathedral, the sun is looking around behind Jesus on the altar, while in the canopy of Bernini in St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, faces of the sun look down at you from the top of the canopy. Other churches show the sun in the apex of the dome, ceilings, and in floors. The sun is everywhere throughout the Christian system today. This heart shows the rays of the sexual symbolism around them. The pagans worshiped the heart. They would tear it from the flesh and offer it to the sun while it was still beating. This worship of the sacred heart can be seen in statuary all around the world. This is the statue of Quetzalcoatl. And although his chest cavity is just ribs, the heart is alive. just as it is on the chest of Jesus Christ. These sacred hearts become an important part of the worship of the Christian church. Here it is in a window above the clouds as the sun in the sky, or as the heart of Mary with seven knives stuck in it, a reflection of the ancient worship of the seven planetary gods. The sun is also seen as a red disk. In Egypt, it's the god Ra. We find here Osiris is holding up the sun, or over the head of Horus, Heraki. These red circles can be seen in the floors of the churches or on their altars as well. Above the head of the king in this tomb is the symbol of Trinity in Egypt. Two serpents around the red sun, representing Ra, Amon, and Osiris. As we look back to the chapel in Westminster Cathedral, we find two serpents intertwined around a red disk. Why has the church adopted these things? The golden disk also represents the sun. We see it not only in Egypt, but in Scandinavia. Evidently, this disk is placed behind the head of a deity to indicate that it is God. Even throughout the Orient, we see this over and over again, and behind the head of Saint Peter. These disks, once called aureoles, now called halos, have filled the church, a remnant of sun worship. This blazing disk around Krishna is clearly a halo, and this ring around this Hindu god is clearly a halo. And here the same type of ring is behind the head of Mary. Another symbol is the nimbus. It came from the pagan worship of the generative powers, the worship of the female organ. The ancient placed gods in this symbol to represent that they represent the power of generation or life, and the church has placed her saints and Mary and Christ in the same symbol. One of the symbols of the sun's rulership over the universe was that of a great big globe. And we see on boundary stones from Mesopotamia a king holding up a globe, or in India, a Hindu god holding the sun in his hand. In Egypt, it was a scarab beetle that was worshipped as the one who held the globe across the sky, or the sun. This idea of holding a globe can be seen in the Greek worship. Hercules holds that globe as he fights his way through the 12 houses of the zodiac. Mithra of Persia holds that same globe, a symbol of the ruler of the zodiac, as well as Isis of Egypt, or this Roman Pontifex Maximus, or Caesar with the globe in his hand. The church adopted this symbol of the 666 God and places it in the hands of its own deities, such as Mary and Jesus. Another form of holding up the universe is seen as being done by Catholicos, or Atlas, in this picture. We find that it's reflected in Roman Catholic altars and on the top of the tiara in the Vatican, where a large globe is found on the top of it, and a great orb is found at the top of St. Peter's Basilica. On this stone found in South America, even these primitive people worship the sun. And we can see that one of the symbols of the sun is a triangle. Far away, thousands of miles across the ocean in Northern Ireland, we see that these ancient Irish people, pagans, carved the triangle on their great monolithic stones as a symbol of the sun. The American Indians carved that triangle on their terracotta coins as a symbol of deity. In Egypt, the triangle also was a symbol of the sun god. Pythagoras used the symbol of the triangle to represent all the mystical powers of God. Wherever we go in the pagan world, that triangle is seen. In the Rosicrucian Museum in San Jose, that symbol is a part of the Rosicrucian symbolism. As we go through the churches, we'll find that they've adopted this symbol of pagan origin as a symbol of the God of Christianity. An equilateral triangle is 360-degree angles, and it represents the 666 God. It has no place in the church. Another worship was the worship of the eye. It represented the eye of God and was found in the capstones of the pyramid Here in the center of this capstone, you'll see a circle with a dot. It represents the eye of Osiris, which was worshipped in fear by the Egyptian pagans. They kept eyes in their pockets to protect them from the evil eye. Even in Rome, we see that this form of worship was adopted, and on this pagan Roman grave is carved a giant eye as a symbol of God. This Masonic pin illustrates the concept that the eye of God is placed in the equilateral triangle. That eye in a triangle is looking down at you from the great dome in Santiago de Compostela's cathedral, or in this confessional box in Torino, Italy, or in this pulpit in the Church of St. Louis in France. Everywhere you go, the church uses the equilateral triangle and the eye of pagan idolatry as a symbol of the Christian God. Another symbol is that of two equilateral triangles placed over itself. It represents the generative principles of nature, and in the center of it is the all-seeing eye of God. All around it are the 36 sections of the zodiac, or the 36 decans, that add up to the number 666. Aleister Crowley designed this pentagram, or hexagram. We see in the center of it the number 6 and the sun. These symbols are found in the Christian churches, as well as in the system of pagan idolatry. Here on a Catholic altar is that satanic symbol in the floor of a cathedral in England, and on the ceiling in Westminster Cathedral in London. Everywhere you go, you'll see these symbols that came from the occult in the church. Here in San Francisco, in the Jesuit chapel there, San Francisco University, the same symbolism. Now that hexagram forms a six-sided object in the center. It was believed that the bee who pollinated the flowers formed the hexagram in the wax because it was a symbol of God. And the bee can be found in the artwork throughout the churches. The pentagram is a symbol of the cosmic forces, whether up or down. We find it used in Satan worship, as well as in the worship of Lucifer. But here you'll find that symbol on Catholic altars and in floors. The scallop shell was a symbol of the universe, or the universal power. We see it reflected in many ways here on the head of Neptune, ruler of the seas, or here held up by Atlas or Catholicos. On this Roman grave in Rome, Italy, the scallop shell represents the universe, and the stairway represents the stairways to heaven. Venus is being born on that pagan symbol, the scallop shell, and here in the scallop shell, she's disrobing herself. This is a Greek coin with a scallop shell. And here, a pagan Venus stands with a scallop shell open, a symbol of sexual fertility. The church adopted that sexual symbol, that symbol of cosmic forces, and you'll find it throughout the churches today. Even in St. Peter's Basilica, we see a great painting of Jesus being sprinkled by a scallop shell. In Santiago de Compostela, that scallop shell represents the brother of Jesus, St. James. And we find these shells are used as fonts to hold the holy water for people that enter the churches. In Westminster Cathedral, beneath the floors of the church is a chapel for funerals. If you look carefully at the apex of the arches, where the symbol of deity should be, they've placed a great gold scallop shell. In the Vatican in Rome, we find that one of the most prominent symbols of the church there is of a great big scallop shell, symbol of the astrological powers. It has no connection with Christianity at all. And here in the floor, at the Chiesa del Gesù, the Church of the Jesuit, is a sun connected to the scallop shells. The ancients believed that as the sun went into the sea, it became a fish god. And in Babylon, that god's name was Awains. We find in India, the name of the setting sun was Vishnu, or the fish. Neptune was part fish as well, the ruler of the seas. And in Egypt, we find that Isis transformed herself into a fish while looking for the dead body of her husband. We find that in Assyria, this concept of the fish was worshipped as well. On this Wasserbecken, or this laver that's set before a pagan temple, we find that there are carvings of priests all around it. These priests have an interesting outfit on. On their heads, they're wearing fish heads, or as Laird, the archaeologist, called them, fish's mitres. We find that reliefs from Canaan show that the priests of Dagon wore these fish's hats upon their heads, or these fish's mitres, as a symbol of their worship to Dagon, the sun fish. In Asia Minor, we find that in the Mysteries of Sibyl, they portrayed her as wearing this sacred fish's mitre. Indeed, throughout paganism, here and there, you'll find that the priests wore this sacred fish's mitre. And here it is adopted into the church. Even today, they're still wearing that fish's mitre or that fish head on their head with its mouth open. Another symbol of the sun is the three-high horn crown. It was a symbol that the sun ruled the heavens, the earth, and the world of the dead, or the underworld. It can be seen reflected in the artwork throughout the pagan world. And here we see a Mesopotamian king with a tiara on his head, Krishna with a tiara on his head from India, and the apostate Hebrew religion of the Kabbalah shows that their great sun god, the 666 god, wore upon his head the tiara, the three-high crown. The church adopted this three-high crown to show the pagan world that the Pope himself was the God on this earth. In the Vatican today, we'll find that there's a great tiara that represents that position of the Pope and is used in certain ceremonies. The crescent, as it lays on its back, is not the moon. It represents the female sexual powers and was worshipped as the womb of heaven. Here it is on the cylinder seal 2,500 years before Christ. It shows it as the deity of the skies. Venus and the statue from the Vatican Museum complex has a crescent on her head similar to horns. Indeed, the worship of the crescent began with the worship of the horns of the cow, the mother of the bull, which they believed was the generator of life. Around the head of the moon goddess of Rome is the crescent moon. And here, around the head of the female goddess is the horns in this birth of Mithra carving. Lilith of Babylon, the goddess of the world of the dead or the world of the gods, is shown standing in the crescent made up of two antelopes. In the church, we see a goddess standing in that sexual symbol as well. It is not a moon in that form. It is the same as it ever been in pagan idolatry. It's a symbol of the female generative powers. In Scandinavia, we find the statue of Mary in the middle of reindeer antlers. Because there weren't any cows up there, they put her in the middle of those antlers as a symbol of her power. But one of the most startling depictions of Mary is in southern France in Lyons. There at the great cathedral, Mary is seen as wearing the horns upon her head. And the breastplate of the Hebrew priesthood is to be found on her chest. This makes Mary the mediator between God and men. Nothing could be further from the truth. The Bible tells us that we only have one priest and one way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ himself. This concept of fertility worship and the worship of the mother captivated the senses of the pagans, and the Roman church realized it would have to adopt it. This instrument, called a sistrum, was used in the dances of the pagan priestesses. Here Isis, the queen of heaven in the Egyptian cult, is seen carrying that sistrum. Isis, in Manly P. Hall's book, is quoted as saying, "I, Isis, am all that has been, that is, or shall be. No mortal man hath ever me unveiled. The fruit which I have brought forth is the sun." The son of Isis is Horus. And in this picture of Isis and Horus, we see her standing in the middle of a nimbus with the zodiac all around her. Her child is the sun god. And when we go to the Vatican, we'll find a great Madonna figure there in St. Peter's Basilica, holding in her arms her baby. And that baby in this Christian statue of a Madonna is the sun. This allegorical concept of the mother and the son can be seen in Egypt and in India here with Devaki and Krishna, as well as the Orient. Both Japan and China have had their Madonna and child figures. This concept of Isis can be seen in statues throughout the Roman Empire. These were the statues who were adopted by the church first for Mary and Jesus. When you look at Mary and Jesus in the churches today, you're looking at an ancient worship that predated Christianity, the worship of the child and the mother. Other statues of the child, as if it's a god itself, can be seen in paganism, but here it's a statue of Jesus, separate from the adult statue of Jesus and worshiped as a god in itself. On this boundary stone from Mesopotamia, we see the god Shamash, the sun god, placed in the womb of heaven, the crescent. We can see it on cylinder seals. 2,500 years before Christ, the concept of the sun god in the crescent, or the male in the female. On this Mithraic altar, or in this Egyptian piece of jewelry, we see the disk of the sun placed in the crescent. Even in India, we see that symbol everywhere, the disk in the crescent. The asterisk was a symbol of the sun in Greece, and here we see three asterisks in three crescents. On this Mesopotamian relief, notice the deity of the sun and how it's represented in the sky. There is a disk in a crescent. Just as there is in this Roman Catholic monstrance. Evidently, the host is placed within this crescent in many of the monstrances. In fact, most of the monstrances that we photographed as we went through these treasuries had a crescent to hold the wafer in. It represented the union of male and female sexes, thus the generative principle. Is that what's being worshipped? And the people don't realize it? The generative principles of nature? On this little door, on the sanctuary housing the instruments of the sacraments, I want you to notice that around the cup is grain and grapes. This was the worship of the god of nature. His name was Dionysius or Bacchus. In Rome, the gods of nature were often depicted as little goat-like men that had grapes, fawns, or satyrs. The worship of the sun god could be worshipped through drinking the grape. It was believed to be his blood. We know that in Mexico, to the sun god, the mace was made in a meal and given to the people to eat. In Egypt, a wafer was served in dedication to the god there. And in Greece, to the generative principles, these wafers also had a place in the communion of the gods. At the Acropolis in Greece, the high priest had three strong men bring in bulls. He baked wafers and put them on the altar there. When a bull ate a wafer, he was killed, and then he was skinned. The people were encouraged to eat pieces of the bull's body and tear them apart, eating the blood and the flesh. Then the skin was filled with grain, and the people again were to tear apart the body and eat the grain. It represented that they were incorporating into their bodies the generative powers. This same form of worship was seen in the Persian god Mithra, the state religion of Rome. Here, these Roman initiates would take a wafer and eat it. In their initiations and their rites, they copied the pagan communions that had existed before. God was called into that meal, and it was passed around among these soldiers. Myth worship is probably the closest to the systems of Roman Catholicism today. It's amazing, then, to find beneath the great cathedrals of Europe excavations of pagan temples, where the Christians were first encouraged to worship by their priests and religious leaders. In St. Peter's Basilica, we find that there are some magnificent candlesticks that are used in the Mass. Now, if you look closely at each one of these candlesticks, there's a face on it. And we would assume that that face should represent the god that the mass is honoring. But looking closely at those faces, you see the head of a being that is part man and part goat. That, friends, is a symbol of Satan. And many of these people don't realize that as they honor the mass, they're carrying on pagan rites to Satan that existed thousands of years before. In St. Mary's in San Francisco, we see this wafer on display in the monstrance, and beside is a door that shows six hot cross buns. It was believed that the grapes were the blood of the god Bacchus, and that the one who drank it and became drunk had his spirit within it. It was an important part of initiation in the mysteries and plays an important part in the ritual of the communion in the Roman Church today, claiming that they're actually drinking the blood of the god. The Bible says that lest ye drink my blood and eat my flesh, ye have no part with me. And now in the church, only the priests are allowed to drink the wine. In the Vatican, on the chalice there, we find a strange looking face, an ugly man smiling with goat's horns. Again, we're looking at the worship of the generative principles of nature. How is it that God in every age could look at this and still love those who are doing it? We know that God is of infinite love, and he knows that man is confused, and he longs to have them wake up. Many, many years ago, a being that was the most glorious outside of deity itself rebelled against heaven. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne, I will be like the Most High. This created being wanted to be a creator. He took upon him the symbol of deity, and he was cast out of heaven. John saw him as a great dragon trying to destroy God's church. As far back as we go in pagan idolatry, the symbol of the serpent was the symbol of those who worshiped the sun. From Babylon to Palestine to Persia, the serpent became a supreme symbol of deity. We know that in Asia, it represented the energies of nature. In India, it represented many aspects of God, as in Egypt, where it represented the chaos, the energies where life came from. It represented the urea, the sacred asp. Here on Nefertiti's hat, we see the urea, the sacred asp. The cherubim with wings protected the pharaoh, and even Tutankhamun had two little serpents with wings beside him. It represents the gates of the soul or the spirit itself from dead. It represented the spirit of the sun. And we find that the convoluted body of the serpent on the graves represented the transmigration of the soul. At Hatshepsut's temple tomb in Upper Egypt, we note a winged serpent with its body spiraling all the way to the sanctuary, representing that one must pass through the serpent to reach God. We know that in Central America, Mexico, and South America, the serpent was worshipped by the natives under the name of Quetzalcoatl or Kukulcan, both flying serpents representing the sun or the morning star. At Chichen Itza, the great temple there, has a stairway leading to the top of it that is bordered by two winged serpents. In Greece, the name of the serpent was Asclepius. He was a counterfeit healer, and he was worshipped all throughout the Greek Empire. Even the great god Apollo was equated with the serpent, as was Athena, the Greek goddess of war and wisdom. In Rome, the serpent became a symbol of healing, as well as the spiritual powers that carries the soul across the heavens at death. In Scandinavia, everything revolved around serpent symbolism. The ships were made into serpents and dragons, and the staved churches that these people worshipped in had carvings of serpents all over. At this staved church, I noticed that above the door was a body of a serpent with its neck forming the lattice work and great wings spread out on either side. One had to pass through this serpent door in order to get into the sanctuary. Here in Chinatown, you have to grab the handles of this serpent door to get into the business. And in Thailand, we find that on either side of many of the entranceways to the temples there are great serpents. This temple shows a winged dragon eagle and a winged dragon lion handle, and a winged dragon goat handle, and finally a great winged dragon itself. These handles have to be pushed before the doors will open, but as one gets back from this sanctuary, you'll notice that it's not a pagan temple, but it's St. Mary's Cathedral in San Francisco. And the court is made of three rows of six crosses in each row, six, six, six. The altar has six steps to the top of the sanctuary. Why are these pagan symbols still used in the church? The church has used them for so long that it knows nothing else but pagan symbolism. All through the years, we find that the serpents are to be found in the churches, on our tombs and in the floors, or here in Westminster Cathedral above the head of Jesus. Most of the dragon serpents that we saw in one place were to be found in the Vatican or the Divining Serpent Center. Here, dragons looked at us from above graves, on floors, or on artwork. Even the canopy was copied from the ancient serpent pillar altars of the ancient world. Those great spiraling canopy pillars represented the serpent around the staff. The serpent represented the energies of both good and evil. And we see here two serpents holding up the cosmic egg. That egg is to be found at the top of Bernini's canopy as well. The ropes were used in paganism to symbolize the serpents, and we find them on the crests of the popes. In the large hall of Bernini in the Vatican, the church is symbolized by a great golden dragon. Down beneath the floors of St. Peter's Basilica in the crypts, we find that one of the popes that called himself Six has upon his tiara six serpents. The lightning bolt was a symbol of the serpent power, and the ancient gods were believed to be able to wield it. As far back as ancient Gilgamesh, we see that this lightning bolt was to be found in the hands of these pagan gods of Mesopotamia. Both the priests and the kings himself carried these divining rods. This Assyrian king from the British Museum holds with his hand a symbol that represents the roll of thunder and the flash of lightning. Osiris is shown holding serpents in his hand, and even Tutankhamun held the serpent staff in his hand. This Etruscan deity is holding a serpent in her hand, and even in the Greek religion, we see Athena holding a crozier in her hand. From the Acropolis, it's clear that that crozier is in fact a serpent. In the Mayan religions, the priests there carried these serpent croziers in their ceremonies. And we find that even in the Orient, in Japan, these little croziers, remnants of the divining rods, were held by prelates. Scandinavia had its serpent crozier as well, held by its priests. This Etruscan priest holds within his hand a spiraling crozier. In Mesopotamia, the priests there held croziers as well. And in Berlin, we photographed this crozier head from the land of Shinar. It has a serpent on the end of it, and this clearly has no relationship with the shepherd's staff, as the church claims. Her prelates carry these croziers even today, just as the ancient magicians and mystics did so many years ago. Many of them have serpent heads on them. Some are carved out of ivory, and still others are carved out of the bones of saints, making them more holy or more sacred. In the eastern part of the Catholic world, we find the croziers have two serpents' heads on them, like this crozier found on the island of Patmos. Some show floral designs representing the generating principle as this, which is beside the throne of the Pope today. Priests and prelates carry these as a symbol that they control the energy forces of nature, irrespective of what they say. This was its original meaning, and here even St. Nicholas carries a serpent crozier in his hand, while this Jesuit prelate holds a double serpent crozier in his hand. Another form of the lightning bolt was as this god, Adad, holding up a three-pronged lightning bolt. That lightning bolt can be found in different forms. Here the god Neptune holds it as a great pitchfork. The pitchfork of Neptune can be seen even on the altars of Mithra, or Hindu deities, or Greek deities. And here we see this Greek deity holding a trident in a Catholic grave. And Jesus is shown here as having these tridents coming out of his head, while in St. Paul's Cathedral, the trident is coming out of the corners of this cross. Another form of the trident is this blessing hand seen on this cylinder seal 3,000 years before Christ. The Hindu gods are seen carrying it, and the Buddhist religion adopted this sacred symbol of the cosmos. These Egyptian priests are protecting themselves from the cosmic force by emulating it by holding their hands in that form. The Spartan god holds it, as well as this Roman faun, and this Roman Caesar has that sacred symbol of the 666 god in his hand. In London, they excavated a statue of Apollo, the sun god, with that three-fingered symbol. Fingers were kept in pockets or hung around the neck to protect people from this satanic god that they believed had horns and a tail and a pitchfork. On the altars of Zeus, we find that this sacred hand was placed as a symbol of the cosmic forces. These votive hands, as they are called, can be seen in some of the great museums of Europe, showing an important part of the pagan worship. Richard Payne Knight donated his collection of sexual symbols to the British Museum, and one of the most important one was this hand representing the cosmos. Here we see the male and female finger raised up together, and the thumb as a generating principle with a pine cone on it. Around it is a serpent representing the energies, a goat's head, symbol of fertility, in the palm, and an altar with three wafers on it. Beneath that is a Madonna and a child. On the back of the hand are symbols of all the astrological gods. These hands were extended to the initiates, and it was believed that energy arced from these hands and flooded them, giving them a cosmic rebirth. It's an amazing thing to see this hand in the Christian church. It's an abomination to God. It represents the 666 God, the rulership of the zodiac. And even today, in a modern age, there are priests and popes that still show this satanic sign. Another form of that sign is this ancient symbol of the male generative organ from this altar in Mesopotamia, or from the head of this Babylonian genie god. You see this fleur-de-lis, as we call it today. Here on the head of Isis, the fleur-de-lis, or in the symbol of Bacchus, the sexual force in nature. But you'll see it on lamps and on altars within the Roman church today. The holding of the lightning bolt can be depicted as holding fire, as Zeus throws his lightning bolt here. But the church is shown, and she has a del Jesuit, the church of the Jesuit, holding a lightning bolt as well. This Mithraic lightning bolt shows arrows. Arrows, universally, are a symbol of the forces of nature, the sexual energy. Here Krishna holds an arrow in his hand, and this Greek doctor in an Asclepian temple holds an arrow in his hand as a symbol of the healing forces of nature. This boundary stone from Mesopotamia shows that arrowhead as the god himself, and we know that these arrows were kept to protect the people from what they believed to be the evil forces. The Romans made an arrowhead out of iron and used it to sacrifice their offerings to the sun god with. It was this satanic symbol that Jesus was crucified with. But the church adopted it because it was pagan, and now it's used as a symbol of deity in the church and worshiped on altars and floors. This chalice shows three of these pagan arrows holding up the cup. And the Cesio del Gesù, we see an arrow through a symbol of the female womb with a serpent with its tail in its mouth around it. This monstrance in one of the Catholic treasuries shows arrows in and out of it, representing the energies that emanate from the wafer. The ancients worshipped the evergreen tree as a symbol of deity. In Mesopotamia, they worshipped the palm tree as a symbol of the rebirth of life. That symbolism is adopted in the Greek and in the Roman religion, and now we find it on the floors and on the altars and graves of the Roman Catholic Church. Another form of this rebirth is a symbol of the pine cone. This pine cone can be seen in reliefs all over Mesopotamia, held by the genii or demon gods. It represents Osiris in Egypt. We see him here holding a staff with pine cones on the end of it. In the Cairo Museum, Tutankhamun holds a pine cone staff as a symbol of his power to rule. And this Hindu god is carrying a pine cone in his hand. Even Quetzalcoatl, with an evergreen tree on one side, is holding pine cones on the other, as is this Greek fertility goddess. The pine cone was adopted by the Romans, and here we see this Mithraic altar with a pine cone in the middle of the equilateral triangle, as well as on a Roman grave. Bacchus is shown with a pine cone staff, a symbol of the sexual organ of the male. And here Dionysius, from the Greek worship of the generative principle, is carrying a pine cone staff on these reliefs. From the Pantheon, we find a great statue of Dionysius there in Rome, held in his hand a great pine cone. Early in the Christian history, they adopted the pine cone as a symbol of life, and we find it everywhere throughout the churches. This ancient symbol of the sexual organs is to be found not only in the church artwork, but the largest one of them is found at a court called the Corte de Pena at the Vatican, the largest pine cone in the world, 2 stories tall. The Pope carries a pine cone staff, much as the pagan deities did anciently, and carries it with him as he travels throughout this world. The bull was a symbol of the fertilizing power of the sun, and the generative organs were worshipped in Rome under the name of Priapus, under the name of Min in Egypt. A form of the generative worship was the worship of the phallus of Osiris. It was placed before the temples in Egypt, and as the sun rose, the shadow of that entered into the temples, representing the fertilizing power of the sun on the womb of the earth. We see from the Muslim religion that this concept of these towers was adopted, and at the Vatican today, one of those symbols of Osiris is placed in the court before the temple of St. Peter's Basilica in the same form as it was in the pagan world. We know that pillars in the pagan temples represented the union of heaven with earth. It was a generative symbol as well, and this has been duplicated in Bernini's colonnade around the Vatican courtyard. Spires are seen in churches all over, and they are a duplication of the ancient worship of Priapus, the generative principle. In the Orient, the energies are symbolized by yin and yang, positive and negative energies. It's represented here in this head of Bacchus, 2 heads, 2 different sides of the one god. This Mayan god shows a black and a white feather on his head, a symbol of good and evil, positive and negative, male and female, as in this Mexican sand painting, or in this Hindu tantra. This Roman floor reflects the same dualism of God in their religion. Masonry has adopted it, and in their initiation floors, they have black and white alternating tiles to represent that God is both good and evil. At the Rosicrucian Temple in San Jose, the initiates are initiated on this alternating black and white floor. In ancient Babylon, the courts of the temple there had alternating black and white tiles as well, as they worshiped the one God as both good and evil. And it's shocking to see that the majority of the floors of the old cathedrals of Europe have the black and white alternating tiles underneath their altars as well. The god of darkness, the god of mystery, the god of evil, was the mystery god, Stur, Saturnus. In Babylon, the first god was Nimrod, and he was of a black skin. His name was Ethiopis, or son of Cush. Osiris, which was the same legend but in Egypt, was a black god as well. We see that throughout the pagan world, many gods are depicted as being black, such as Vishnu in the Hindu religion, and Krishna, the supreme manifestation of the Hindu deity. Going back to the Vatican, we'll find that there Peter is black as well. As the foundation of the ancient Babylonian system was black, so the foundation of the modern one is as well. Kissing the feet in pagan idolatry symbolized the worship of God. We find in the Hindu religion they kissed the feet of their spiritual masters and believed that vital force and energy would flow through these pictures and carvings of feet. In a Hindu temple, we watched people kissing these feet, and it was explained to us that these were the lotus feet, and they received energy from that. But as I was in the St. Peter's Basilica and saw people lined up to kiss the feet of Peter there, I realized that even the foot kissing had been adopted into the system of Roman Catholicism. The holding of the keys was pagan in origin. It represented the one that opened up the light and closed the world of darkness. The Pope claims to have that power today. It was first given to him in the 4th century in a dream where Janus and Sibyl, the pagan gods, came and gave him the keys. This omnipotent power that's claimed for the Pope gives him the authority over the world of hell, a religious teaching that was adopted to keep the people in abject terror and fear. It has no origin in Christianity. It's believed that the Pope has the power to release these people from hell if he would like to. But as we go back into the system of pagan idolatry, we will find that every culture had their form of hell, from the Orient to the Babylonian world. There's nothing new about eternal burning hell. The pagans often symbolized the departed spirits of the dead as birds. They saw the eagle flying above the heaven, and to them it was an excellent symbol of the departed spirit. And we see this concept of the eagle carved on tombs and graves. The great phoenix represented the rising of the sun, and the double-headed phoenix represents the supreme aspect of God, that he's both good and evil. The winged spirit here represented that man's departed spirit ascending into the heavens. And in the churches, we see these birds everywhere. The phoenix is often seen as carrying the scriptures on its back. These birds have no place in the churches, but over and over again, they are placed on altars, such as this pelican feeding her young. What does the pelican mean anyway? Well, in Manly P. Hall's book, it represents the sun feeding its children in the mysteries of the secret societies. We know that the peacock in India represents the sun god or the bearer of the gods, and the Yezidis believe that it represents Satan. And here it is in Westminster Cathedral. The ancients worshipped the dead. That was their worship. They didn't know a living God. They only believed that their gods once lived on earth and ascended to the heavens. The Pantheon in Rome was a place where people gathered to worship the astrological gods. Those gods have been transferred to the Vatican that holds the largest collection of pagan antiquities in the world. This concept of worshiping the dead has been adopted in the church as saint worship. Here we see that in Egypt, they had 365 gods, one for each day of the year. Did you know that in Roman Catholicism, there is a saint for every day of the year, a saint for every occupation? Every one of those saints at one time or another is a reflection of some pagan deity. As you go into the churches, you'll find that there are sarcophaguses of the dead everywhere you go. In fact, I believe that the church itself is the world of the dead. This great altar in Burgos Cathedral, though it's magnificent and four stories high with saints all over it, is nothing more than a continuation of the worship of the dead. The popes are embalmed and placed in caskets, three inside each other, placed beneath the floor of St. Peter's Basilica, and there the people gather to pay them homage, to do their rosaries before them and kiss their caskets. Indeed, even some of the smallest cathedrals and churches have beneath the floors places in the old world where they buried their dead. Notice on this cylinder seal from 2,500 years before Christ that this priest is holding something that looks like little balls in its hands. Reliefs from Babylon and Mesopotamia show the priests and the genii holding beads in their hands. Yes. Beads was part of the worship of Babylon here from the Pergamon Museum. These beads were taken from the Babylonian bull cult. Or these beads of Pharaoh Amenhotep IV were buried with him in his grave. They were prayer beads. And throughout Egypt, we find them in the graves as a special part of the worship of those people. In India, the Hindu religion and the Buddhist religion all used beads in their prayers. Even in the Muslim world, we find that prayer beads were an important part of the worship of Allah. And when you see prayer beads in the church, you know, as a matter of fact, that they are from the pagan worship. They have no place in Christianity. Candles represent the immortality of the soul. The fire was the earthly representative of the sun. It was ever to be kept burning in the pagan temples, such as this Buddhist pagan temple. But when you look at the altars in Catholicism today, there's not even a faint reflection of paganism. It's an absolute image of the pagan world before. People spend a lot of money buying candles to place before altars of saints who can't hear or see them. Incense is offered up around the altars during the Mass and during the ceremonies of Catholicism, in the same way that incense is offered up in the Orient in Hinduism centuries before. But the strangest part of Catholicism, it's its veneration of a human priesthood. In the book Dignities and Duties of the Priest or Silva, we find that Saint Alphonsus de Liguria gives the doctrinal view of the position of the priest. We find in obedience to the word of his priest, hoc est corpus meum, God himself descends on the altar, that he comes wherever they call him and as often as they call him and places himself in their hands, even though they should be his enemies. And after having come, he remains entirely at their disposal. They move him as they please from one place to another. They may, if they wish, shut him up in the tabernacle, expose him on the altar, or carry him outside the church. They may, if they choose, eat his flesh and give him for the food of others. Oh, how great is their power! The people have to come to the priest to receive the sacrifice of Christ. The power of the priest is the power of the divine person, for the transubstantiation of the bread requires as much power as the creation of the world. Thus, the priest may be called the creator of his creator. The idea that Jesus is recreated and his sacrifice duplicated in every wafer is an abomination. The priest is the most sublime of all created dignities, an infinite dignity, an astounding miracle, great, immense, and infinite, exalted above all celestial heights. He is inferior only to God. The priests in this position stand in the very place that the pagan priests did of the ancient world. Christ never initiated an earthly priesthood. A priest, in absolving a sinner, performs the very office of the Holy Ghost in the sanctification of souls. To see people lined up to confess to an earthly man, feeling that they'll receive sanctification or forgiveness because of that act, is one of the saddest things. Innocent III has written, indeed, it is not too much to say that in view of the sublimity of their offices, the priests are so many gods. How could it be that men could be so blinded? But we realize that that form of Catholicism that we see today came out of raw pagan idolatry. As priests were set aside for the worship of God, so women were set aside in the ancient temples as vestal virgin or priestesses. Today we find young girls are prepared for a female form of priesthood, the nuns. The nuns in the open convents appear to do many wonderful things, but in the closed convents they're used by the priests. There they suffer, and there they die, and never allowed to see their family or their friends again. We don't fully understand what goes on behind the closed doors of those convents, but someday I pray to God that they'll be opened up and the truth will be revealed. The wearing of towers symbolized the rulership of the heavens, the earth, and the underworld, the great tower builder, the Pont Maximus, and this is the name of the Pope. It's to be seen over doorways and on tombs throughout the Vatican. Names of the Pope have been chosen by the church to add up to the name, to add up to the number 666, such as this name Vicarius Filii Dei, the Vicar of God. In Latin, it adds up to 666. On this sacred door, we see that each of the popes were 666 gods. This door has crests for each of the popes since it was put in. And notice those crests? Why, in each one of those crests are the number 666. Three bees, three fleur-de-lises, six-pointed stars. Latinos, or the Latin-speaking man, adds up to 666 in the Greek language. That man allows himself to be carried as God on the Sedia Gestoria in Peter's Basilica. And here we see the Pope sitting on a throne with a zodiac band around the top of it. Dux Cleri, captain of the clergy, equals 666. Ludovicus, vicar of the court, adds up to 666. Anciently, Zeus presided over the circle of the zodiac. Atlas held up the zodiac, both symbols of the 666 God. But here on this publication, published in Rome in 1527, Pope Clement is seen sitting on the zodiac. One part of the universe turned by a devil and the other part of the universe turned by an angel. The Pope here is being depicted on this book of astrological charts as the 666 God, the ruler of the zodiac, the God of both good and evil. Italica Ecclesia adds up in the Greek language to 666, the Italian church. The center of that church is St. Peter's Basilica in Rome today. And as you get up above and you look down over the colonnade, you'll see that it's surrounded by solar symbols. A Latina Basilica, the Latin kingdom, adds up to 666 again. That kingdom is symbolized on this coin from 1825 as sitting upon, as a woman, sitting upon a globe with a band around it. The church itself is the 666 God. Who is the God of Roman Catholicism? It looks like Jesus, but it is a counterfeit of the true God. And on this altar in the Jesuit chapel in San Francisco are six occult symbols of the sun representing the God of the Mass. In St. Peter's, in the Vatican in Rome, we notice this monstrance with three little letters under the case. SFS, SOS, stigma SOS, are three hieroglyphs for the number six. The people don't realize when they bow down and when they worship this system and when they see this man at their head that they're really bowing down to that 666 God. In the Greek transliteration of the name, Satan adds up to the number 666. We understand and it's clear that the system of Catholicism is in fact the beast of Revelation. What is it, Mark? Going back, we find that God gave mankind a mark or a sign of his own authority. That sign resides in the Sabbath. Some scholars have felt that in the name Sabbath, the word sign of the Father is hidden. Sab being Father, oath being sign, the B representing a dwelling place. But a study of the Bible proves that the Bible Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath, is the sign that God is the Creator, that He is our sanctifier and Redeemer, that He is our spiritual rest, that we're His people, and that in keeping that law among the other laws, it is a sign we keep all of God's commandments. Jesus pointed out that we were to keep the Sabbath after He died. His death didn't change the law of God. And he told his disciples that when Jerusalem was destroyed, to pray that their flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day, Matthew 24:20. How did the day get changed? How did the sacred sign of God get changed in the minds of the people to the Mithraic day of worship, Sunday? This is from the Catholics' Converts Catechism on Catholic Doctrine. Why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? We observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church and the Council of Laodicea transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. How prove you that the Church hath power to command feasts and holidays? By the very fact of changing the Sabbath into Sunday, which the Protestants allow of. Have you any other way of proving that the Church has power to institute festivals of precept? Had she not such power, she could not have done that in which all modern religionists agree with her. She could not have substituted the observance of Sunday for the first day of the week. For the observance of Saturday, the seventh day, a change for which there is no scriptural authority. It was the Catholic Church which, by the authority of Jesus Christ, has transferred this rest to Sunday in remembrance of the resurrection of our Lord. Thus, the observance of Sunday by the Protestants is an homage they pay, in spite of themselves, to the authority of the Catholic Church. Constantine I made the first closing law for Sunday in his effort to unite paganism and Christianity. The church picked up the movement, and a number of laws later on the same object, they had transferred the day of worship from Saturday to Sunday. You may read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of Sunday. The scriptures enforce the religious observance of Saturday, a day which we Catholics never sanctify. James Cardinal Gibbons. I have repeatedly offered $1,000 to anyone who can prove to me from the Bible alone that I am bound to keep Sunday holy. There is no such law in the Bible. It is a law of the Holy Catholic Church alone. The Bible says, remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. The Catholic Church says, no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in reverential obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church from a lecture from T.N. Wright. 1884. Again, he says, I have repeatedly offered $1,000 to anyone who will prove by the Bible alone that Sunday is the day which I am bound to keep, and no one has called for the money. It was the Holy Catholic Church that changed the day of rest from Saturday, the seventh day, to Sunday, the first day of the week. Again, T.N. Wright, 9 years later in 1893. From this, we may understand how great is the authority of the Church in interpreting or explaining to us the commands of God, an authority which is acknowledged by the universal practice of the whole Christian world, even of those sects who profess to take holy the Scriptures as their sole rule of faith, since they observe as the day of rest not the seventh day of the week as commanded by the Bible, but the first day, which we know is to be kept holy only from the tradition and teaching of the Catholic Church. Henry Gibson, Catechism Made Easy. Reason and sense demand the acceptance of one or the other of these alternatives, either Protestantism and the keeping holy of Saturday, or Catholicity and the keeping holy of Sunday. Compromise is impossible. James Cardinal Gibbons, Catholic Mirror, December 23, 1893. In 1893, Rome gave a challenge to the Protestant world. That challenge to the Protestants was because the Protestants wanted to enforce a federal Sunday law in this country. The Catholic Church quickly moved in to point out that their doing that was in homage that they pay to the sign of the Roman Catholic Church's authority. Let's read a couple of excerpts from that article from the Catholic paper at that time. The Adventists are the only body of Christians with a Bible as their teacher who can find no warrant in its pages for the change of day from the seventh to the first. Hence their appellation Seventh-day Adventists. Their cardinal principle consists in setting apart Saturday for the exclusive worship of God in conformity with a positive command of God himself. Repeatedly reiterated in the sacred books of the Old and New Testament, literally obeyed by the children of Israel for thousands of years to this day, and endorsed by the teachings and practice of the Son of God whilst on earth. Rome's challenge. It's not yet too late for Protestants to redeem themselves. Will they do it? Will they indeed take the written word only, the Scripture alone, as their sole authority and their sole standard? Or will they still hold the indefensible, self-contradictory, and suicidal doctrine and practice of following the authority of the Catholic Church and wearing the sign of her authority? Will they keep the Sabbath of the Lord, the seventh day, according to the Bible, the Scripture, or will they keep the Sunday according to the tradition of the Catholic Church? Friends, the beast. This is the mark of the beast, the observance of Sunday. I believe that God is going to bring every Christian to the test over this issue, that one day Sunday will be a legal enactment, and everyone will have to take a stand on either the sign of God or the sign of the sun god. A message must go out to the world today, and that message is that Christianity has fallen, that she has accepted pagan doctrines, that she is as that image or that harlot in Revelation chapter 17 portrays, the mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. God cannot save the average Christian with the beliefs and in the condition he's in. He's calling them out of this system of apostasy. In Revelation chapter 18, we read the last warning of Jesus to this world. And after these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven. An angel means a messenger or a message, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. The whole earth will receive this message. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon, or confusion, the great, is fallen. And has become the habitation of devils. The Christian church has become the habitation of devils, folks. And the hold of every foul spirit in the cage of every unclean and hateful bird, all of the teachings of the worship of the dead of paganism are to be found within the doctrines of apostate Christianity today. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication or her false teachings, and the political powers of the earth are in an unholy alliance with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. The Christian world is the wealth of the economy of the world. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, that ye receive not of her plagues, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Dear friends, probation is closing today. Jesus is coming soon. And before he comes, he's going to have a faithful people keeping the law of God. Will you be one of those people? I urge you today to take your Bible in your hand and go to the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to guide you into that deep relationship with him.